journey is. The trailer hadn't even come out yet. It was literally just the still.
Yeah, it's crazy person talk.
So you took that email and you put that into the dialogue?
In a way, yeah. I mean, there was a handful of things from our first meeting with Rob that we brought to the character. There was no movie before he reached out to us. We were trying to make something else. And, you know, we had this desire to do, you know, a pulpy genre thriller, thrilling movie that actually thrills you and feels like you can fall off the front of your seat. And, you know, and I don't know, having gotten to know him in that brief time that we met, I immediately saw, like, a Vietnam War vet and someone who's just, like, constantly trying to, you know, avoid the world. And in a way that the character, that we brought that to the character.
Okay, slow down a little bit. So you get an email out of the blue from Robert, and you guys have never met before.
No.
And what was your first thought when you got the email?
He's not right for the movie that
we had a long conversation. We're like, what do we do with this?
And if it wasn't for Sebastian Vermeclard, who's here, the producer, I might not have even responded. No, of course I would have responded, but it would have been a different response. I was like, what do I do?
I need to get my email
right in back.
What did you say? How did you get my email?
Report to junk. Yeah.
Robert, what can you put into words a little more about what about their work was so appealing to you that drew you?
I mean, initially it was just some kind of weird instinct, and then I saw the trailer for I saw Heaven Knows What, and I just liked I really like the energy they bring to movies, and even Danny Longlegs as well. It's like kind of even it's like slightly more like slightly less extreme, but it's still kind of frenetic and electric. I think it's a really, really difficult thing to do, and I like that, and I also like the performances in Heaven Knows What with the seamlessness between the world of the movie and the real world around it, and I just really wanted to be in that kind of a true ensemble.
So tell us then about how this story came about.
When we first started talking to one another, I was just reading Executioner Song by Norman Mailer for the first time, and the Brother book In the Belly of the Beast, and also published by Norman Mailer, and I just downloaded every episode of The Cops, the greatest American TV show, and
we're just watching it.
We were just watching it before we left for the other screening, and I mean it's just there's always been a fascination and an obsession with the American criminal and the prison ethos in America and how trapped everyone is and breaking free. I'm always trying to break free, and I hate time more than anything in the world. That's why I call it good time. But like I really can't stand time, and I just want to create the illusion that it doesn't exist. And that's why I love movies so much, is because we come into these dark rooms and you just like time travel in a weird way.
But then you have a movie like Good Time where time is so important. You know, you can't help but escape that impending minute mark. You know, time distilled to its.
Speaking in terms of time, like. And before we wrote the screenplay, because Rob, you know, isn't the character, he's, you know, there's parts of him in it, but he's very far from the character. That speaks to his incredible performance. And of course, Benny's performance, let's not talk about that either. But we had to basically know who this person was inside out. And I did obsessive work in developing the backstory. And I realized we couldn't overlook a 3-month gap, so it's like when he's born all the way up until like, and as it got closer to the beginning of the movie, it got like every day. Every day he was released from prison, what he did, and how he did, his interactions with Nick and the grandmother, and it just let us know the characters so well that when we put ourselves as writers, me and Ronald, like, we just knew exactly what this guy would do.
Well, one of the things that I saw in reading about the film was that you mentioned Cops, that you kind of wanted to pursue one of these characters that you might see in Cops. Mm-hmm. Like, what's his day-to-day life like when he's not in front of these cameras, right?
Mm-hmm.
When you were developing all this backstory and developing all these characters, Robert, you were on another film. You were like somewhere else getting notes sent back and forth from these guys, yeah?
Further away.
Columbia,
and a long time before that as well. I mean, I think feel like I've always been sensed that, whether it was just images of people's mugshots who were just kind of just felt sort of right, or whether it was like this documentary, A Year in the Life of Crime, this old HBO documentary, but also there would be a few scenes at a time, and then a backstory would come, and it would kind of come piecemeal from all over the place, so it's kind of an organic kind of web that came, and rewrites of the script and new drafts, blah, blah, blah. And it was just over a really, really long period of time, and I thought it's strangely satisfying to see, even if pieces of a character are abandoned and they're rewritten completely, there's just to know the kind of the process, you get more on the same wavelength.
I really want to know more about your preparation process. I mean, the transformation that we saw in Robert in this film is astounding. I just was blown away by this. And can you talk a bit about how you went about preparing for the role? There's a physicality there that's incredible, and obviously vocally, and as Josh said, your upbringing is pretty far afield from that.
it's a fantasy figure. I mean, it's like, you know, you grow up watching movies, and it's kind of Connie as a character belongs to a pantheon of cinematic, not archetypes, but just characters, which I grew up watching and grew up wanting to be, not necessarily wanting to play, but like kind of idolizing, like, and being influenced by, and kind of, I mean, in terms of how you approached it, I mean, it's sort of just having a really long period of getting on the same page, and also because all these guys, pretty much everybody involved in the movie is from New York, and they're from Queens, and it's a specific type of energy which you can just, if you're just around it long enough, you start absorbing different bits of an energy, but also it's just like it's not like playing a character which you wouldn't want to be in some way, that you kind of, a lot of me wants to be that.
You were bothering me. You were like, well, no, I was willing to engage with it. You were like, I want to meet all these people.
And it's kind of
Phil and Kaz, all those guys.
Yeah, it's exciting. I think the whole point in doing any acting, in being the satisfying part of it, is to fully empathize with the character. And I think the most easy way to fully empathize with it is to try and kind of inhabit it. And I think, it was fun. I mean, it was like, me and Benny would go and basically be in character for like entire days, and I think it was also, I'd never done that before, and there was one day we went to a Dunkin' Donuts, and I was still kind of, you're thinking that someone can see through a performance, but when you suddenly realize that people aren't, just people in the real world aren't seeing through the performances, it's like, oh, well, I guess we're acting in a way, but it's not acting. It's like you're kind of—I don't even know what you're doing at that point.
So you're fully in character at the Dunkin' Donuts.
Yeah. Dunkin' Donuts in Yonkers. Yeah, it was near the. Then we went to a garage a friend of mine has, and spent about 8 hours there, and just listening to stories, and then picking up on one story, and then this guy was like, "Oh, I know exactly this type of guy. I know who Connie is," and took us on a walking tour of his recently deceased brother. And it's just like this really peculiar, really incredibly independent guy. And we were walking around these personal landmarks, this guy in Rocky Point, Long Island, and we just couldn't believe it. He's like, yeah, this is where he thought he killed a guy and he buried him, but he didn't bury him deep enough, so the guy came out and like walked down the street, and I saw him right there, covered in dirt. But like, the story, we were reliving them, and we were like taking pictures almost. It was awesome. I mean, it was great. I mean, Rob really constantly was saying, like, I want to meet someone else, and that was great for me. Like, went to Manhattan Detention Center in jail, through my weird research, I ended up kind of becoming friends with the commissioner of jails in New York City, and strangely, I met him, and someone kept calling him the commish, and I was like, why is he calling me the commish? He's like, oh, I'm a commissioner. I was like, commissioner of what? And he's like, 137th Street. He's like, oh, commissioner of jails of New York City, 5 boroughs. And I was like, wow, really? He's like, yeah. He's like, anytime you want to come, I'll show you whatever you want. So we went down to the Manhattan Center, and he was not, Connie wasn't able to speak yet, but we were developing the look and the vibe, and he wouldn't really open his mouth the entire time. And we went through a really in-depth tour where the inmates thought that we were like working for the government. And we were like, inmate outreach. And they were like, yo, let me talk to you.
Were you dressed in the suit?
I was dressed in the car salesman suit, yeah. And it was incredible. And it was amazing to see him kind of start, you know, when you raise the stakes on an actor or a performer, of like, listen, you have to become someone, because the stakes of being shouted out and called out are not only embarrassing, but also like, they're real, you know what I mean? It's just like someone screams, hey, Rob Pattinson, what are you doing in jail? Like, you know?
But someone did think I was a scared straight.
In a weird way, I would argue it's almost more frightening to be called out in the Dunkin' Donuts, you know, because it's such a small...
Also, Benny, you were in character.
Oh, no, but
you were being really difficult with the guy. Yeah.
I was ordering a very specific thing. I had a very specific order I wanted in mind, and Connie clearly knew that, and they were treating me in a specific way, and then for Rob, I was like, okay, this is what it's like to have Nick in the world, you know, with him. And it was just awesome for me also to feel what it's like to have this guy as my brother. You know, what is that like? How does he care about my wants or feelings, or does he care? You know, these certain things that were very helpful. But getting called out in that Dunkin' Donuts, it's a very small, they're all very small. Like when they're you know, if you, it's kind of, it would be very embarrassing. It's like in jail, yeah, it's scary, but in the Dunkin' Donuts, there's something more existential about it, you know.
Maybe more embarrassing for jail.
They're behind they're in jail. So.
I want to ask you about your preparation process too, Benny, for the role of Nick. You had put on some weight at the time that you guys were about to shoot this. You were preparing for another role, I guess, right?
Well, yes. In 2010, with Ronald Bronstein, we were going to make a movie where I kind of went through my own emotions and feelings, and kind of came up with like the foundation for what we didn't know was Nick at the time. It was Jordan, and I developed this way of talking that I could use, and then
speech and kind of
And so everything became this character, Jordan, and we were going to make a movie with him. We filmed a bunch of rehearsals, and the movie never ended up happening, but we had this person who existed in this fictional reality that just never ended up happening. And then 7 years later, it's like, okay, what? Let's revisit this character. And then because I put on weight for another role, like actual muscle, and then we did an interview for the financiers, and to say like, hey, I can play this part, I can be this person, and so I came in as Jordan. I went in thinking I was going to get money from this woman. I wasn't quite sure what was happening, and it got very uncomfortable in the room. And I said, can I leave? And she said, yes, of course. You're not holding it here, you know. So I got up and left. We sent it to the financiers, and like, that guy's great. Let's cast him. And they didn't know it was me. And I was like, I had seen these. People had spoken to them, but after watching that, I realized, okay, there was a physicality now. This guy could take whatever he wants when he wants, so there's going to be a hardening of his own feelings, and it's going to be even harder to get inside, whereas before he was a little bit younger and not as strong, so it was a little bit more, you could mold him more, but now he's had 7 years of just...
And then that. Throw into the mix that Benny just had a baby, Benny just had his son. And 2 weeks before we started shooting, and it was just like that added to the melee of it all kind of for him.
And you know, the adding to the grit and the authenticity of the film, there's a lot of street casting, there's a lot of actors who, you know, didn't come from the acting world. Some of these guys were doing their first appearances on film. Talia,
yeah, who plays Crystal, sure, yeah.
Who plays a 16-year-old girl, and the guy at the front who is...
Peter Verby,
who is the counselor.
Yeah. He's a cinephile in New York who was actually kind of part of that other project that we were talking about from 2010. But he's a criminal lawyer. He was a public defender. He was out part of the character building. Him and Rob sat down a bunch and talked about the type of people that he, you know, represented and how they act.
He was an advisor.
In a way, yeah.